जैसे आपको ठीक लगे।
और मैं लीव हो जाऊँ मीटिंग से?
नहीं लीव तो मत करना, हो सकता है जरूरत पड़े बीच में।
मैं लीव होऊंगा तभी तो आपको एडमिट बना सकता हूँ।
अच्छा ऐसे पॉसिबल नहीं है?
नहीं मोनिका मैम आ गई, उनको बना दूँ पहले। मोनिका मैम, आशु मैम आज किससे ज्वाइन हुई है? आशु फोन आईफोन से, वही आशु मैम ही है?
आशु मैम तो नहीं दिखा मेरे को।
एक आशु आईफोन आ रहा है।
हो सकता है मैम आज फोन से लॉगिन हुई हो।
सुमन?
यस मैम।
हाँ, मेरे पीछे का बैनर ठीक दिख रहा है? आज उल्टा तो नहीं दिख रहा?
नहीं फैन चल रहा है क्या ऊपर से थोड़ा सी वो?
हाँ फैन चल रहा है, फैन बंद कर दें।
फैन के राइट हैंड साइड में कुछ है जो थोड़ा सा वो आ रहा है।
मैम ठीक है आपका बैनर आज, कोई दिक्कत
नहीं। ये फैन की वजह से आ रहा है क्या?
हेलो,
फैन तो मैंने बंद करा दिया।
मैंने कर दिया आपको, कोस्ट बना लिया अपने आप को, कर लीजिए।
अच्छा, और एक चीज है सुमन, जब ये आस्क टू अनम्यूट, अगर हम किसी को अनम्यूट करना चाहते हैं तो हम उसका आस्क टू अनम्यूट करते हैं, तो वो बंदा अपने आप को अनम्यूट कर ले, कोई दिक्कत थोड़ी है?
एक बार किसी को करके देखिए, नरेंद्र जी को करके।
मैं करती हूँ, मैं को होस्ट हूँ ना। जैसे ये है, कहाँ पर है
नरेंद्र सिंह है ना सर?
नरेंद्र, हाँ, इसको मैं अनम्यूट करना, अनम्यूट करती हूँ, तो इसका आस्क टू अनम्यूट आ रहा होगा।
नरेंद्र जी अपने आप को एक बार करके देखिए,
आप अनम्यूट कर पा रहे हो अपने आप को? नरेंद्र?
हाँ कर लिया इन्होंने,
कर लिया ना?
हाँ
हाँ ठीक है, नरेंद्र कुछ बोलो, लेट्स सी वी कैन हियर यू।
हेलो,
हाँ ठीक है,
हाँ मैम बिल्कुल आवाज आ रही है, क्लियर है मैम।
ठीक है, तो म्यूट कर लो अपने आप को।
ओके मैम, ओके।
अच्छा तो प्रदीप, कैन यू हियर मी?
यस मैम, गो ऑन।
हाँ तो ऐसे ही करना है, चैट बॉक्स पे जब क्वेश्चंस आएंगे ना
जी मैम,
यू कैन सिलेक्ट द क्वेश्चंस, यू कैन आस्क फॉर अनम्यूट टू दैट पर्सन। ठीक है, तो वो अपने आप अनम्यूट करेंगे अपने आप को, एंड दे कैन आस्क द क्वेश्चन।
ओके मैम, फाइन।
ठीक है, उनको ये वाली ये इंस्ट्रक्शंस दे रही है दैट प्लीज अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ एंड आस्क योर क्वेश्चन।
ओके मैम, ओके।
उन्हें अनम्यूट करने का राइट दे देना।
ठीक है मैम।
ठीक है, ये सिलेक्टिव होता है तो कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, वो को-होस्ट कर सकते हैं। अच्छा मैम जो है वो आकृति मेहंदी तक से एंटर हो रही है। ठीक है,
यस मैम,
ओके। And Pradeep, please see people are in the waiting room. Please
yes, ma'am. I am admitting them. Huh? I am admitting.
Okay. Right. So let us wait for the principal, sir.
Akriti, ma'am, is joined. I am accepted.
To... Has Sunny? Huh? Has Sunny joined?
Not yet, ma'am.
Okay.
Madam, speaker person is joined.
Hi, Dr. Monica.
Hi ma'am. Ma'am, I'm just waiting for the principal sir to join. Then sure. I'll start.
Sure.
Ma'am, Kusha ma'am join करेंगी क्या आज?
आज तो Kusha ma'am नहीं करेंगी, Ashu ma'am करेंगी। उन्होंने कर लिया join?
Ashu ma'am ने कर लिया।
अच्छा ठीक है।
एक बार शेयर स्क्रीन करके देखूं क्या?
एक मैम वो हो जाएगा
ना?
हाँ हाँ, नो प्रॉब्लम, मैं कर देती हूँ शेयर स्क्रीन।
परमिशन लेने के लिए
शेयर हो गया ना मेरा? स्क्रीन शेयर
नहीं, आपने कर दिया। ठीक है,
आई हैव शेयर्ड माय स्क्रीन, इज इट ओके?
यस मैम, इट इज फाइन।
प्रदीप हाँ आर यू सीइंग इट
एवरीबॉडी या या या
ओके
या एवरीवन इज सीइंग इट
फाइन फाइन फाइन
अनिल सर जॉइन
अनम्यूट ओह सुनो
आपकी मार्च में क्लास हुई थी ना उदिन आप आए थे अपने फ्रेंड पेज नहीं बनाया था ना उस दिन अब साइन करके जाना तो मेरे क्या ध्यान आएगा
सुमन जब सर ज्वाइन कर जाए प्लीज मुझे बता दीजिएगा
प्रिंसिपल सर
हाँ जैसे ही ज्वाइन करें प्लीज बता दीजिए
हेलो मुझे एक सर सारे टीचर्स के वो मेल आईडी उसमें तो सारे टीचर्स के नाम है जैसे कि डिपार्टमेंट और इंग्लिश तो उसमें मेल आईडी हो तो आप भेजते हो ना सर या थोड़ी उसके बाद दे देना दे दो घंटे के बाद या जब आपको टाइम हो भेज देना तो हम कल भेज देंगे अभी हम मेल आईडी बना रहे हैं जब आप खोल लोगे हाँ ऑफिशियल मेल आईडी जो आपने सर्कुलेट किया है कैसे भेज सकते हैं कोई तरीका है नहीं आप मतलब पहले कोई तरीका बता सकते हो कि हर टीचर पासवर्ड में स्विच है हाँ हाँ अपना पासवर्ड ज्वाइन कर गया ठीक है हाँ ये भी लो सर ठीक मैडम सर ज्वाइन हो गए
ओके ओके Oh, so let us start the session. Am I audible to everyone? Okay, a very good afternoon to everyone present here. On behalf of SLC Shablal College, I, Dr. Monica Goyal, once again welcome you to the second day of this national workshop on emerging trends in science and technology, issues in these unprecedented times, which is organized under the aegis of DBT Star College scheme. It is my proud privilege and a moment of immense pleasure to introduce our eminent resource person of today, Dr. Nisha Mendiratta, advisor and scientist G in the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Dr. Mendiratta has more than 30 years of experience in the research and applied fields of science. She graduated in physics from Delhi University in 1987 and did a post-graduation in agricultural physics from Indian Agricultural Research Institute in 1989, followed by a post-graduate diploma course in satellite remote sensing and GIS for the application of agriculture and soils at the Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Department of Space, Dehradun. She did her PhD in agricultural chemistry from Meerut University. She started her professional career in 1990 as scientist at National Remote Sensing Agency, Hyderabad, in Department of Space. She carried out core research in the field of microwave remote sensing applications for soil moisture estimation. She then joined IIRS Dehradun as their faculty in 1991 and carried out intensive research in crop characterization using satellite data. She joined the NCM RWF program, currently under Ministry of Earth Sciences, as senior scientific officer during 1992 and worked for medium range weather forecasting and crop weather modeling. In 1998, she joined NRDMS program of DST as scientist and worked in the specialized domain of natural resources management. Presently, she is spearheading climate change program of DST, which is responsible to implement the two national missions on climate change under National Action Plan on Climate Change launched by the Prime Minister of India. She has been representing the department in the international platform at Conference of Parties conducted by UNFCCC since 2015 and organizing special technical events on climate change, which is attended by more than 190 countries. She is the recipient of the meritorious PG fellowships at IARI, where she was ranked second in all India level competitive entrance examination. She has several research papers, articles to her credit, which were either published or presented in various national and international forums, and has also edited and co-authored two books published by TERI Press and several integrated technical documents and reports on the scientific programs implemented by her. She is an identified resource person and serving as a member in many national and international committees and task forces. Ma'am, please keep your video on so that we can see you. Ma'am, we are so delighted to have you amongst us today. Your experience and expertise in the domain will be a great value addition in the workshop. I now invite our principal, sir, Professor Rabi Narayankar, who has been the driving force behind the conduct of this workshop at such a grand level, for his remarks. Sir.
Namaskar. Thank you, Dr. Monica. With this, I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Nisha Mendiratta, the resource person for today, and who is going to deliver on this very pertinent topic that is climate change. And as you see, more than yesterday, there are more than 220 participants, and today it is already crossed 150. So that shows the kind of enthusiasm and interest among the science scientific community who are participating in this workshop. And we are eager to deliver on the emerging trends of science and technology during this pandemic times. And I, belonging to this education sector or this academic field, we also have a lot of responsibility, not only to our students, but also to all the stakeholders. You know, that's why we are in this pandemic. If you go back to the genesis of this pandemic, then we can get this answer. So like the planet Earth is a, you know, full circle, we are again back to square one, where, you know, there are several questions or question marks over the genesis, the way we are conducting ourselves, the way we are, you know, the exploiting the planet Earth and all those things. And as you are all scientists and a lot of people are students, they are budding to build a career on this. So we have a lot of expectations from this community to bring out with those innovations or solutions which are very, very sustainable in nature, which is not only going to only impact the climate change also, but also will have a very, very positive impact towards this sustainable development. With this also, we have to keep in mind that we are also one of the first signatories to this SDG goals, which I think we are going to achieve by 2030. So India is one of the first signatories. So we have enormous amount of responsibility on our shoulders. And I hope for like deliberations like this and workshops like this will definitely take the right directions towards achievement of this sustainable development goals. With this, once again, I will compliment the organizers, including Dr. Ashu, Dr. Monica, and their whole team for very successfully organizing this. And once again, I welcome today's resource persons, Dr. Nisha Mendirata, and I would also impress upon her that she can also collaborate with the scientific community available here and at my own institution, so that lot of things with collaboration and co-creation, we can build a lot of knowledge base for the development of our country. So with these words, once again, I welcome all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your encouraging words. Now may I please invite Dr. Nisha ma'am to conduct the session. Ma'am, the stage is all yours.
Very good afternoon to all of you. Respected Professor Ravi Narayan Karji, Dr. Monica, Dr. Ashu, all the organizers, participants. From DST side also, I would like to extend my warm welcome to all of you in such a challenging time. And also I would like to compliment the organizers, Shyamlal College, for organizing such an important event, which is really required to be understood by the students and also the community working in the science era, that what is the importance of science, what are the challenges, what are the issues, and especially in this pandemic time, how we can make use of this strength, the scientific power, to make our life a little comfortable. And of course, as mentioned by Professor regarding the SDG goal, I'm so happy because I am already working on these goals through my programs in DST. Though I have not covered that as a part of my presentation today, but I would be briefing about it, what we are doing. And certainly we would like all of you, faculty and also the youngsters, to give a little attention to what I am saying today. And then we would be very happy to get all of you on board in the science and technology era together. So I have made a brief presentation. In fact, in the series, as already mentioned by Dr. Monica, so I think I am initiating the scientific talk. I have been given this privilege to address all of you in the beginning. So then I thought of picking up the S&T aspect first in my presentation. Though most of the students, as I inquired from Dr. Monica and Professor Ray also said, that the participation is overwhelming and more or less all of you are belonging to scientific streams. So I will just start my presentation. So the share option is there, I think, Dr. Monica?
Yes, ma'am.
I will share just your screen. That. Yeah. 1 minute, please. It's taking a little bit time. Is it
yes, visible?
Yeah. So I can start with it.
Please go with on the slideshow. F5.
F5.
Yeah.
F5. I'm
just Suman, please tell ma'am what to do.
It has come.
Yeah. Right, ma'am. Yes.
Sorry, I'm screen pura nahi dekh pa raha mujhe. Just 1 minute. There is little like the visuals are coming over the screen. Yeah. Now it's clear, no?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah.
You can see.
So. Yeah. Actually, over the screen, these bullets are coming. But are you also like getting those bullets over the screen?
No, ma'am. We are seeing it, yeah, correctly.
Some of the letters are getting. Minimize option. Just 1 minute. 1 minute. Just please hold for a second because over the screen I am getting some other windows. So anyhow, I'll start with it. If I get some problem, I'll stop in between. So, as friends, the topic which I took is emerging trends and S&T issues in climate change science. Down. Yeah. So my presentation would broadly cover science and technology, what is it exactly, Indian S&T scenarios, climate change issues and concerns which all of us are facing in our country, and then the COVID-19 vis-a-vis climate change. Yeah. So this is broadly for all the students. I am trying to say what is science. So I would have loved to have an interactive session with the students face to face. You know, I would have got several answers from them. But just to make the thing simpler, I would like to say that science can be termed as a way of learning about the natural world through observation, experimentation, and logical reasonings. So these three terms are very, very important for all of you to understand. All of us should know what is around us. We should be keen to observe. Then with little experimentation, which we are doing in our department, in scientific departments, lot and with logical reasonings, we come to certain conclusion. All science is based on two assumptions. The first one is the natural world behaves in a consistent and predictable manner, which we can very easily understand if we observe properly. And through careful systematic study, we can understand and explain the natural world's behavior. So science talks about it, these two things. Now, I am just trying to bring certain inspirational quotes from the eminent scientists. Students, all of you might have heard quite much about Albert Einstein, Isaac Newton. They are the leaders, they are the pioneers in the science field, scientific field. So as per their quotings, the thing which they mentioned, we cannot solve problems with the same thinking we used to create them. And imagination is more important than knowledge. This statement is one of the biggest statements which says that all of us should be thinking, which will be the driving force to generate knowledge about a certain aspect. Isaac Newton mentioned that if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Nothing is done in a vacuum. We must all stand on our forefathers to better ourselves and the world around us. Tackling the challenges of the world today will require that more than ever. So these are some of the reasonings or the thought process which came to the mind of these geniuses. Now, why I'm showing this slide is, it's a very well-known, which from our childhood we have been seeing, the apple. Now, what is this theory telling us? If Newton, sir, was sitting below a tree and his thought process started thinking that why this happened? Why an apple has fallen on the ground? You know, his mind started questioning. And these kind of questions gave to an answer which led to a big story, to a big theory of Newton laws and gravitational story, motion of relatively theory. So the important thing is not to stop questioning. This is what I wanted to tell all of you, that we should question the things which are happening around us, and the quest to know the things, the process will lead to an innovative idea, which will further lead to a scientific research. Now, here in a nutshell, we can say the science is about learning new facts, which will lead to solving the problems. And further, we may be in a position to invent many new things. So here you can say the whole loop of problem solving talks about identification of the problem, exploration through informed and create ideas. Then we have to select the best idea, and based keeping that as a pillar, we have to build this idea and bring out the innovation, and technology helps us in taking the solution to that. Now, what is technology? Technology is the innovation, change or modification of the natural environment in order to satisfy perceived human wants and needs. Now you can see in all possible sphere of our life, whether it be transportation, power, or medical science, climate science, everywhere the technological tools are very important, and without that, we cannot even think of getting a solution. Now the importance of technology. As I said, it has made our life much easier. Evolution of newer and faster modes of transport and communications we are able to get due to technological interventions. Business, may it be small or big, they need a thrive on technological solutions, and learning has become really interesting. It is also required to boost scientific research, which is ranging from genetics to space technologies, and advancement in agriculture, which on which our country is heavily dependent. All of you might be knowing our country's economy is dependent on agriculture sector, and many agricultural tools are leading to the precision farming, which is giving us lot many solutions and keeping our yields to the required levels. Now S&T, as I said, the impact of science and technology can be seen in all the sectors of life, let it be healthcare, agriculture, industry, entertainment, education, communication, our lifestyles, explorations, defense, and all these sectors lead to the economy of our country. So broadly we can say S&T is the pillar for the economy of our country. Now, I am coming to the next section of my presentation, Science for Society. All of us have understood very clearly the power of science and the importance of science and technology in day-to-day's life. And the buzzword which is coming nowadays is science should be for the societal benefit. All of you might not be knowing, but I would like to tell you that government has come up with a new policy, which is SSR, Scientific Social Responsibility. Each and every department whosoever is working in S&T area, their outcome of their programs with whatever they are implementing and developing with the funding from Government of India should lead to the societal benefit. Why it is so? Why this decision has been taken? This policy is right now in draft form and soon it will be implemented. You will see that everywhere SSR policy will be the main gist of all the S&T related programs. As I said, that our nation's growth is for the humanity's welfare. Here, R&D plays a very important role, which will emerge from the individual level. So all the students, the faculty, you are working at your own individual capacity, and we call it human capacity building. Then at the institutional level also, we are working for the R&D area, which will again feed to the national development. So here I can say that quality research clearly is a driver of better productivity, which will give rise to the higher competitive ability, and then it will lead to the generation of more jobs and higher economic growth for our country. So it develops all individual, society, and nation as a whole. So you must see where you are also playing role as an individual in meeting to the nation's target objective. Here, just to give you a feel that broadly there are four pillars which lead to the economic growth of our country, which gives us the information and which we put together, and many programs are developed based on these parameters. So what are these? Here we can say the products, natural products, mainly agricultural products, then industrial products in which technology plays a very important role. Industries require a lot of technological innovations to make it faster. Information products are very important for them to not only analyze but bring the information to a certain level which can be utilized for the nation's benefit. And then finally it comes to the knowledge products. So world is transforming into a knowledge society as a whole. So broadly a societal transformation is happening. Now here why I brought this piece of information is when I am talking about S&T and economic growth of our country, it is a well-known fact which has been accepted globally that all the policy makers and economists, they have come to a conclusion that more than 50% of our investment, it is to be attributed to the science and technology. If the countries who have given more importance to the science and technology for the development of their nation, they have given a very, very successful outcomes to the world. This is a well-known fact, and all the developed countries like US, I will show you in another slide also that how much contribution the developed countries are making towards R&D of their nation. Yeah. So just have a look at this slide. All of you might be knowing about GDPs, gross domestic products. So this slide is telling about the R&D contribution of each of the country. Here you can see US, Germany, Japan, China. They are investing around 2% of their GDP in S&Ts. And here if you see India is also developing country, emerging country. And here our GDP contribution is around 9%. And with this little contribution also, we are able to showcase remarkable results. We are one of the best country which is showing scientific interventions in the global era. And if we do more contribution in GDP, we are going to do much more remarkable work. This is the latest statistic which I thought of showing. Here you can see the among the BRIC countries, how much contribution the countries have got. India is in this position and we are working towards rising our level to the highest top nations. And here I must tell you that in terms of scientific publication, India occupies third position worldwide. Our scientists, our researchers are doing, they are doing very good research, and very good publication in the cited journals are coming up. This is a point to be celebrated by all of us. Now here, this shows a trajectory of S&T. I will not spend more time in that because here I will come straight away here. When we are talking about industrialization era, more or less 100 years back. Initial time, in our ancient time, this way our forefathers started. We started our things with hunting, then weapons came to the picture, then compass instruments, scientific, and there are many more colleges which are giving quality education to our students, and we expect them to explore S&T era and bring out innovative work as desired now by the whole world from our country. Now, only two more slides I will talk about technology, then I'll come to the climate change science. These are the emerging technologies in India. As I mentioned, in 2020 onwards, the more focus is now towards artificial intelligence and machine learning, cloud technologies and Internet of Things, automations, space technology. Already all of us know that with the Chandrayaan, India is also one of the pioneer country which has leap marks in the space technological interventions. And a new program which is launched by Honorable Prime Minister was One Sun, One World and One Grid, which talks about getting the solar power and bringing electricities to each and every corner of India. And here I must say that the Ministry of Non-Renewable Energy is working very aggressively to meet this goal. Space-based solar technology is also India is looking at. China and Japan are already investing very heavily in this particular field. Electric vehicle is another area which is really required, as it is 3 to 5 times efficient than the internal combustion. And the energy utilization is also minimized if it is made from fossil fuel. Department of Science and Technology has also launched a program in the electric vehicles. Medical technology innovations. So the students who are from botany, and also maybe if there are some students from medical, they can also add on to many more examples in the medical technological innovation. I'd like to mention that all of us are facing the COVID challenge, and our latest kit has been developed by IIT Delhi, and ICMR has also come up with a kit. In fact, one of the institution, Aryan Institution from Department of Science and Technology, J. Jawaharlal Nehru from Pune, they have come up with a kit, test kit of COVID to ramp up the coronavirus testing in the country, and which will be which is under testing process right now, and all of us will be getting it soon in the time to come. So friends, I just wanted to give you a little feel about S&T, its power, its potential, and in India how active we are in meeting these demands. Now I'm coming to another aspect, which is climate change science issues and challenges. As already mentioned earlier, that climate change is one of the section in which each and every citizen of our country is getting affected, especially in this challenging time of corona, and the pollution levels, they are also affecting our immunity very badly. So I thought of picking up this topic just to make you understand that what is the climate, what is the weather, and what are the challenges all of us are facing, and how we can contribute to combat the ill effect of climate change, which can help towards sustaining our environment, and also we can move towards achieving the sustainable development goal as mentioned by Principal Sir. So I'm starting with that because this topic may be a little bit new to some of you. So I just thought of picking up certain basic things to so that you can get connected to the next portion of the presentation very well. Weather, as all of you know, it is short-term changes in the atmosphere. In a single day, what kind of weather we are feeling, like today the weather is very hot or it's humid, it's going to rain, all these things are very well mentioned under the weather. Whether the day is sunny, it is cloudy, it is windy, these are all weather parameters. Now, when we talk about weather in a long-term basis, it can be, the long-term means it can be over a decade, it can be even hundreds of years, thousands of years, then it talks about climate. As you know that the whole world is divided into five broad regions: polar, temperate, Mediterranean, desert, and tropics. All of these regions are characterized by different kind of weathers. Here you can see. And we are coming under this category, which has got lots of rain, hot and wet weather, temperature relatively constant throughout the year. It's moving. Yeah. So now, what kind of weather systems we are facing in our continent, subcontinent? During winters, we find western disturbances, fogs. Monsoon, we find monsoon low, depression, vortex, tropospheric cyclones. Cyclones, all of you might be aware of. Many cyclones hit our country. And students might be knowing about many names, nomenclature. Sometime it is Katrina, sometime it is named on some other celebrity. So these are the cyclones, vortex. In pre and post monsoon time also, we find cyclone, thunderstorms, dust storms, hailstorm, tornado, easterly wave. There are many more events or the occurrences of the weather events. So I will not go more into that. It was only just to give you a feel that in our country, what kind of phenomena we face. Now, these phenomena can be due to natural occurrence or it can be man-made. Natural means if there are volcanic eruptions, if there are huge high ocean currents, then it leads to many kind of phenomena, weather phenomena, climate phenomena. But nowadays, as I told that from the past more than 100 years, after the industrialization era, there is burning of fossil fuel, there is huge increase in that, deforestation is happening. In urbanization also, there is change of lifestyle. So all these human activities, they are leading to the global warming. Now, what is global warming? This talks about, this cycle talks about the whole scenario. Here, as you know, the carbon is stored in the fossil fuels. When fossil fuels are burned, then there is a carbon emission into the environment, and which again leads to the warming of the whole atmosphere. So broadly, this is the global warming. Now, this is just to make it a little clear to all of you that when the fossil fuel is burned, this is the natural way of emission. This is the artificial or man-made kind of thing. When this transportation is moving on the road, this smooth road, and this industry is on, giving such a huge heat from the chimney. Here you can see that the various kind of primary pollutants are going to the atmosphere, which are carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, SO2, NO, NO2. Many hydrocarbons are also going to the atmosphere. There are many suspended particles. The list is really very big. So when we are talking about global warming, all these particles, emissions, they contribute to the increase in the temperature of the environment in which you are living, all of you are breathing. So this is a great cause of worry, and this is increasing day by day. This only talks about the kind of activities, what all we are doing, which is leading to the emissions, more emissions, and again polluting our environment. You might be thinking, all of you, we are going to the restaurants, to the hotels, that is our style of living, that is our way of living. But you know, when we are going there, we are having our food, we are having our packets of foods, it is contributing to the emission like anything. This requires a different lecture altogether. So I will not go into the details of all this, but all of you can relate very well to these aspects and can think that how you can contribute towards minimizing your role into the carbon emission aspect or the global warming. Domestic cooking, constructions, concrete batching, road dust, industries, AC sets, aircrafts, biomass burning, fly ash, power plants, industries, DG sets, and then vehicles, different kind of vehicles. So all of them are the great polluters. There are different source categories. The list is again a big one. So now I'm coming to the information which I want to share with all of you, that with these sources of carbon emissions, the carbon dioxide, CO2 concentration, which is the largest greenhouse gas. And here I must say that CO2 is one gas which has got a largest residual effect in the environment. Now you may ask, what does it mean exactly? Residual effect means if a carbon dioxide is emitted day one, like today, if some certain portion of CO2 has been emitted into the environment, it will remain in environment for next many years. Sometimes it is more than 100 years back, which was emitted in the environment, that is again accumulated. We are breathing that air with which our forefather had faced long time back. And our next generation is going to again face the same thing which we are emitting right now. So we have a great contribution to the emission and also in our environment. Here you can see, this is the level of CO2 at the time of long time back. And this is about 500 years back. And now we are here. It is around 414 part per million against 280 part per million, which was at the time of 1850. So around 150 years, we have got almost one third of the CO2 accumulated in the environment. And this increase in global temperature has been linked to the increase in carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere. So this graph tells you about that. You can very well relate both the things. Now, the greenhouse effect. Already you might have understood that greenhouse effect is broadly because of natural phenomena, but the global warming is increasing day by day, and human activity are the main contributor, are the main cause to increase the global warming. So just give one little attention to these arrows, which will make the whole process very clear. Greenhouse effects means from sun, we are getting solar radiation, it is reaching our earth and also our atmosphere. Earth is absorbing the solar radiation. It is re-radiating it back. Now, in atmosphere, we have got several suspended particles who absorb these emitted radiation and make our earth warmer. And then, you know, if these particles are not there, if greenhouse effect is not there, our earth will not be in a livable position. We won't be able to live because of the great heat which is coming from sun directly to the earth. So greenhouse effect, greenhouse gases are really making our life livable. But when it is increasing due to the human activities, then more and more greenhouse gases are there, which are absorbing more radiation, and there is a trapping of greenhouse gases in our environment. Here you see the solar radiations are coming with the same intensity, but due to the global warming, less heat is escaping to the space as compared to the earlier or the natural times. So we are absorbing more radiations here due to greenhouse effect, which is not good, and it is required to be checked at this stage. So this is all with these slides are talking about, and I hope it is now quite all of you might have understand that these rising temperatures are very damaging to our natural environment, and we must do certain practices to check to this rise. Now this is the message which we have received from IPCC. IPCC is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. This is the fifth assessment report in which more than 190 countries are participating with their data and their analysis. As I mentioned about science, so I am talking about climate change science with you. I am sharing some of the well-known facts which have been brought out by the international scientists in the form of this report. This report says that in the past climate change, based on 100 years of global observations, these observations are taken from satellite data, and also each country have their own BUR reports, which is giving a lot of information about the climate change at the global level. There is an increasing trend in global surface temperature, which is leading to the sea level rise. And then there is an increase in the frequency and severity of extreme weather events. Now, what is extreme weather events? As we are talking every time in our country, that pehle to aisa nahi hota tha. Nowadays, the weather is so bad. It is too hot. It is too cold. And why there is a flash flood? Why there is a cloud burst? Why there is such a flash flood and bloff also you might have heard, that in the lakes there is outskirt burst. So these are all extreme weather events which are happening more, which was not there in the past many years. Why it is happening? It is happening only because of the climate change and the global warming. This is again some of the information shared by the international experts through this assessment report. Here only I will tell you that overall Earth's average temperature had risen by 0.9 degrees centigrade. Now you may say that this is a very small amount, 0.9 degrees, almost around 1 degree centigrade. How we are all going to be affected by a simple 1 degree rise in temperature? But when this temperature is over a long period of time, it has got tremendous effect on different natural resources of the world. And there is a tendency which has been projected by different climate models that it will be risen by the end of this century up to the level of 4 degrees. It may go up to 4 degrees, which will be much more alarming, and the world may not be in a position to lead a very normal and sustainable life. So this is a real cause of worry, and all of us have a great role to play, as I said in the beginning. And at the end, I will share with you that what all you can do to minimize these changes of the climate. Now, because of this almost 1 degree rise of temperature, glaciers are retreating almost everywhere around the world. And even in our Himalayas also, the impact is seen. You might have observed, if some of you are belonging to the Himalayan areas, maybe from Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal, all of you might have felt that now the temperature is not that cold there. The environment is not that cold. There is a rise in the minimum temperature. The nights are not that cold. And the days are also very warm. So it is all because of climate change. And even one of the study which we are doing in DST, they mentioned that the growing belt of apple, which was earlier at the higher altitudes, it has moved further more higher. So in the Himachal, whatever apples we were getting, all those crop is also getting affected because of climate change. It is only one small example. Likewise, there are many studies which are witnessing the reverse or the negative impact of climate change on our Indian economy as well. Now see sea level rise. When temperatures are high, it is affecting our glaciers, the ice is melting. So it is again having impact on the sea level. Sea levels have rose about 8 inches in the last century. Here, this is only to give you a feel. You can see the Glacier National Park in US. In 1913, you can see the ice-clad mountains. But here you see, in 2012, almost it is looking like a barren landscape. So this is what, this has minimized to this level. In our country also, there are many areas where the same scenario is seen. Here also you see the aquatic habitats. So students who are from botany, they will also study, I'm very sure, in their BSc courses, the ecosystem balance, the landscape, and the different kind of species in different environments, their adaptability. So here you can see how the things are moving. They are migrating, they are dying due to change in climate. So this is about all kind of effects of climate change on our natural ecosystem. Forests are depleting, the quality is getting degraded. There are many now, the forest fires also we are finding every time it comes in the newspaper. It's again because of climate change, they are also main contributor of forest fires. Coastal areas, erosions of beaches, inundation of coastal lands, additional cost to protect coastal communities. So again here, it is affecting the Indian economy as well. Agriculture, crop yields, irrigation demands. And in agriculture sectors, there are many more issues which I have not given here. Under water resources, water supply, quality, all the things are getting affected because of climate change. Species and natural areas, already I said, loss of habitat and species, cryosphere, snow, ice, diminishing glaciers. And health sector is also very badly affected by climate change. The weather-related mortality is increasing, infectious diseases are increasing, air quality, respiratory illness, that is again increasing. And in the current pandemic as well, the weather again is a main force in spreading the problem. Here, you can have a look. Like all of you might be knowing about Eiffel Tower. That's why I chose this slide, so that you can also get a feel of it, that how it was submerged by flooding of the river in the year 2016, which is a very, very rare scenario to look at. Here you see the polar bears. All of you might be knowing they are the real species which are found in ice, but due to shrinkage of ice cover, you see the place of habitat, how they are struggling, how the bear is struggling with the baby here. So not only humans, everyone, animals, all kind of as I can say stakeholders, they are getting affected by the impacts of climate change. So just to summarize whole thing, you can see that the global increase in temperature or the global warming, they are influencing all physical, biological, human systems in totality. So a holistic approach is required to understand the impacts of climate change, which is again a very, very challenging task. Worldwide, everyone, all countries are doing their share in order to understand the impact of climate change. Already I have mentioned, so I am just skipping this slide. You have already understood the negative consequences, which again, as we are feeling, the droughts are frequently increasing. They are causing forest fires, they are destroying our crops, melting of glaciers, they are causing sea level rise, which is eroding the coast. And again, they are destroying many means of subsistence. So there are many more. There are extreme natural phenomena, floods, which all of us are already feeling. So as I have told, that what is the future projection of climate change? There is a projection that it will increase from 1.7 degree to 4.8 degree centigrade in this era. and hot days and heat waves will become more frequent and colder days less frequent, as I mentioned about the hilly terrain of our country. So likewise, it is going to be felt all across the world. Rainfall will increase at higher latitudes and near the equator, and they would be decreased in the regions of the subtropics. Rainfall extremes are projected to become more intense and more frequent in most of the regions. So rainfall extremes, today also it rained. So I was just telling Dr. Monica, just to be on the lighter side, that it's such a nice weather. Today all of us should have sit together and have this session. It would have been more enjoyable. You see, we were just laughing and just discussing a little bit about today's good weather. But again, all of us are experiencing extreme rainfall in Delhi. Earlier time, there used to be many rainy days, but less intense. But nowadays, there are only few number of rainy days, but very intense. Sometimes it is so intense that it is raining hours, many hours. And next day when we are on road, we literally cannot drive our vehicles. So this is all is contributed to the climate change impact. And global mean sea level rise will be up to 26 to 55 centimeter, which is again a very, very high figure. If like emissions are still continued to be like the way it is happening right now. Yeah. So after this, I am coming to the our country's role or our country, what we are doing with regard to the climate change, meeting the challenges of climate change. Yeah. Here, UNFCCC is one international environment treaty, which we call it United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. In UNFCCC, there are more than 187 countries, rather around 200 countries this year, who are working together to understand the climate change, its status, its scenario, and then future projection and what we should do for it. As I mentioned in my first slide, that science is about knowing, understanding, experimenting, and then analyzing. So UNFCCC has taken that lead role to understand this challenging task, which all the countries are getting affected and they are contributing to. The report, which I just shared with you, the summary, little summary of that was from UNFCCC only, which is known as assessment report. One very important agreement UNFCCC had come up with in the year 2015, which is termed as Paris Agreement. I'm very sure all of you might be knowing, it is a very common framework, common, very famous agreement, which Honorable Prime Minister Sir did in the year 2015. Since then, India has been participating very actively in all the UNFCCC conventions, which is known as Conference of Parties. Every year it is organized in one country, and I am very fortunate to be part of this convention. Since 2015, when India started taking lead or participating very actively in UNFCCC, I have been representing my department, Department of Science and Technology, and we are conducting specialized session on the missions, which I will tell you. I will tell you what are the things which our country is doing. So here the goal was set to increase the global average temperature to below 2 degrees centigrade above the pre-industrial level. As I told that it is right now 0.9 degrees centigrade and projections are it may go up to 4.8. So UNFCCC made an agreement in which more than 187 countries ratified that we will try to contain the emissions of our country below 2 degrees centigrade. But the efforts all the countries will do to limit it up to 1.5 degrees centigrade. So India has also taken this oath along with other 170 nations. Yeah. Now India's role in combating the climate change. India has taken a very active role in the year 2008, which came up in the form of National Action Plan on Climate Change, which was launched by Prime Minister Council on Climate Change, and it was unveiled by Honorable Prime Minister Sir. Under NAPCC, there are 8 national missions on climate change, which are trying to look into all the scientific aspects on different sectors. I showed you some of the sectors in which the impact of climate change is quite evident. So the missions talk about solar mission, enhanced energy efficiency, sustainable habitat, water sector, sustainable agriculture, Green India means forestry. And there are 2 specialized missions. One is for the Himalayan ecosystem, and another one is a strategic knowledge for climate change. These are the 8 missions which are being implemented by the concerned ministries. They are the nodal ministries, and Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change is the nodal ministry to coordinate with all the participating ministries and come up to a common report or the framework for our country, which every year we are submitting to UNFCCC in the form of BUR. BUR is biennial report of our country. And here I would like to say that these 2 missions, Himalayan Mission and Strategic Knowledge Mission, are being implemented by Department of Science and Technology. And I am working for these 2 missions. Here, it's a very, very important quote of Mahatma Gandhiji, which is valid, which is a statement which we need to understand and which we need to adopt in our life as well. The earth has enough resources to meet people's needs, but will never have enough to satisfy people's needs. So it is a very, very informative statement which gives us the feeling that we are not dearth of resources. We have got plenty of resources around us, but we need to know how to conserve and utilize those resources which can lead to meet the people's requirement in a very, very optimized manner. But here the thing is, we need to know how much we need and how much will be required for each and every individual to meet their requirement. There is no need to go extra miles to get extra things so that the other one is depriving of their own resource sector. So this is a kind of statement which gives us an idea that how we should live our life and how we should adopt and make our programs which can lead to the nation's growth. These, keeping that in view, the guiding principles of India's climate change program, and not only climate change program, also the sustainable development goals, they are also thriving on these issues. High priority must be given to improvise the human development sector, maintain and sustain rapid economic growth. It should lead to a greater focus on adaptation of climate change. And we should choose our future development path to avoid emissions. This is an overall strategy which has been adopted by Government of India under NAPCC. Here you can see the states are playing very important role. Each state, as I mentioned, that Himalayas, there is a different program. There are many problems which all our country is a very vast country, which has got many, many different ecological zones. All are having different kind of ecosystems, different kind of problems, different kind of physiographies. So there is a need to understand all the sectors in details. And keeping that in mind, all states were assigned with the task to prepare their state level action plans, which has already been done, and now they are in the process of revising their state action plans. So these state action plans and UT action plans, they will give us the roadmap that where, what kind of research is required, what kind of scientific interventions and technological tools are required to meet the challenges of their state. And based on that, adaptation strategies can be worked out by a team of scientists and technologists. And all of you youngsters, you have to take that role. You have to play that role by understanding all these aspects in much details during your graduation and also in post-graduation level. And then you should be in a position to contribute towards the national goal by your S&T intervention. So these are, out of 5 missions, these are the 4 missions we are working on the adaptation strategies. Here, why I am telling adaptation, adaptation and mitigation are 2 terms which all of you might be knowing. I'm very sure I will not talk about it. But adaptations are, I will not say easy, but adaptation strategies are doable in the current scenario. We can immediately co-opt the strategies in our day-to-day life. And mitigation measures are little expensive and those are more time consuming. So that also we are doing very well, our country is doing. But adaptation strategies are those strategies which immediately all of us can adopt to minimize, or not minimize, to adapt ourselves to the ill effect of climate change, which we need to do. So as we were talking about sustainable development goal, so this is talking about sustainable development path, which needs to be ecologically sustainable. And which, how to make it ecologically sustainable? When we do optimum utilization of our resources, we don't waste our resources, and we avoid emissions. These are the principles which can take us quickly to the sustainable development goals. Now, what is India's take at the international level? I will tell a little bit about it. So I was mentioning about 2015 agreement, Paris Agreement. So here our Honorable Prime Minister, sir, he made a statement that climate justice demands that with a little carbon space we still have, developing countries should have enough room to grow. So this statement also I leave to all of you, all youngsters, to understand and analyze and let me know. I will not explain this statement because here our country is looking towards you. You are our young leaders and you have to take, understand this message thoroughly and then do your studies and contribute to the nation in S&T era. So what will it lead to? Ultimately, it will be leading to the success, and it will, of course, be requiring moderating our lifestyle, which is mandatory. We need to moderate our current lifestyle if we want to go to the developmental pathway. This already I have mentioned that these are the key elements of Paris, that we need to limit our temperatures below 2 degrees centigrade and preferably 1.5. above the pre-industrial levels. Pre-industrial levels, I showed you the carbon dioxide emission level, which was 280 ppm, and now it is 414, more than 1/3 of that level. So again, CO2 and temperature, they are linked parameters. So this again is a different science. So in today's lecture, I'm not going to tell more on this aspect. It requires a lot of time otherwise. Yeah. So what do we say? This, the next part of this agreement was increasing the ability to adapt, as I mentioned, adaptation strategies to the adverse impact of climate change and foster climate resilience and low greenhouse gas emissions development pathways. Here, just to give you a feel about the CO2 emissions worldwide, you can see different countries, their contribution, CO2 emissions. First is China. You can see China is around 28%. followed by United States 14%, and surprisingly, India is in third position. We are contributing around 7% of CO2 emission to the whole world. Rest of the world is around 22%, and these are other countries, and you can see it's ranging from 1 to 5%, but India is showing 7%. There is one more criteria with which emission is measured, which is per capita. If we see in our country, the population is quite high as compared to US. When we work out the emission in terms of per capita, it is much lower, but overall contribution is much high. So here again, it talks about leading a sustainable lifestyle, which will certainly lead to minimize the total emission of our country in the time to come. If all of us take this pledge and all of us start living in the required way, sustainable manner, which is required to be taken up. This is only a tracker. So I will only show you this thing, India's position on climate actions. India, as I'm saying, is one of a very active member in UNFCCC. And NDC is another term, which is nationally determined contribution, which UNFCCC has asked all the countries to determine their own. In fact, this is INDC, that is their internal NDCs. Each country has to understand their emissions rate, and then they have to give certain commitments to UNFCCC that by the year 2030, then by the year 2050, and then by the end of this century, how much contribution we would try to minimize and we will try to contain. And here it shows that we have given our commitment up to 2 degrees, and we are in a position, we are able to achieve this goal if all the departments, ministries, related organizations, individuals work together to understand this goal and then work towards minimizing the emissions. Now, as I mentioned, I am almost coming to the end of my presentation now, and I wanted all of you to know that how, as an individual, you can contribute to minimize the adverse effect of climate change and make our country more ecologically sustainable. The first one is conservation of natural resources, which already I explained to you. There is no need to tell more about it. Rather, now I will expect students, you to come forward and tell me the ways and means how you can think of optimum strategies to conserve the natural resources in your own areas, in your own fields. Let it be your thematic area, let it be your own hometown, how you can think of. That is one question I am posing to all of you. If it was an interactive session, I would have stopped my presentation here and would have asked all of you individually. But I will wait for my answer on this particular slide from all of you. Then the second is green energy pathways. Now, this is again a very important thing, green energy or zero carbon footprints. How we can achieve that? There are several things which are coming up. Green buildings are being constituted. Biofuels are being utilized. They are being promoted in the vehicles. Non-renewable energy sources. So I want you to answer me. What are these non-renewable energy sources? I will not explain it here now. I want you to answer me, maybe in the chat session or later on. This is the second question I'm posing to you. How we can reduce the carbon emission by using these resources? What are those? Are you using this? Have you started using in your day-to-day life? Transportation modes. Here I am very sure all of you know very well that public transport is there, and this odd even formula that was in practice in the last year by Delhi government, which also showed very good results. At that point of time when carpools were started, the emissions level, aerosols level had minimized. So that itself shows that when we do our little bit of our efforts, it leads to good results. So transportation modes, these are one or two, but you also suggest what kind of other transportation modes you comes to your mind, young minds. You have to give us the solutions. You have to give us the new innovative ideas. Waste disposable. Now you see the waste, the way it is disposed in all over. Sometimes it is scattered. Sometimes, you know, the way it is disposed, it leads to so much of methane emission, which is again not good for environment and also for our health. There should not be any plastic. It should be, there should be environment friendly packaging. All of us are nowadays, it's an online era. We just give a order online for delivery of pizza, burgers, and all these students, I'm 100% sure all of you might be doing it very aggressively. Maybe nowadays due to COVID, you might not be, some of you might not be doing, but it is a regular practice. Even at my home also I find. But you see, when this packaging material, it comes in aluminium foil or any other package, so that again leads to the emissions. Even whatever computers we are using, whatever emails we are sending, the phone call we are doing, all these lead to carbon emissions. The carbon footprints are getting added. There are many more examples in our day-to-day life which I can quote, but you come up with many more things, no? Which you think in our day-to-day life, these are contributing to the emissions and how you can think of minimizing those. Afforestation. It is well known for me, there is no need to tell, that deforestation is really taking away our green, lush green area, taking away the nature from our grip, and more land is coming into the industries, into urbanization. That is again leading to so much of problem. So one of the adaptation strategies, afforestation. And here I'm happy to say, actually, I have not shared the Paris Agreement, all the recommendations, on which there were many, which were on this thing, afforestation and part, that we have to increase our green intensity. There is one important call from my office. I have to take this call. Sorry for interruption. Hello? इतना भी सेशन चल रहा है, आधे घंटे में कॉल कर लो, कुछ इम्पोर्टेंट नहीं है तो, हाँ कोई अर्जेंट नहीं ना, या सॉरी, सो आई एम बैक टू दिस, एफॉरेस्टेशन एंड क्लाइमेट रेजिस्टेंट क्रॉप वैराइटीज. नाउ हियर देयर आर मेनी वेंचर्स व्हिच मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर हैज टेकन अप, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एनवायरमेंट एंड फॉरेस्ट हैज टेकन इन फॉरेस्ट्री एस्पेक्ट. मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर इज डूइंग वंडरफुल वर्क in bringing out many resistant crop varieties, which are resistant to water, which are resistant to pest and disease, different kind of calamities. So many good innovative things are coming up. Technological boon is there in agriculture as well as in all kind of sectors, which we should know. And then sustainable lifestyle. As I said, there should not be any wastage. There should not be wastage of fuel, food, water, many more. The list is very long, which all of you can add on. So this slide, I want all the students to upgrade, add their examples and give to me. So this is one tutorial I am giving to all the students. And all the students mean all the students, whosoever theme they belong to, whether they are BSc, General Science, Botany, or IT, physics, mathematics. All of you need to work on it. Then only I will feel the purpose of this conference is fulfilled. And I will see to it, after this conference is over, I will ask the organizers, Professor Ray, that what answers we got on my this query. And I am very strict about it. I am telling all of you, you have to provide your input on this slide to me. Yeah. Now, the last part of my presentation. As all of us are facing pandemic, and there are many concerns which are arising in our life, the first foremost, which I mentioned in my presentation as well, the aerosols. As you know, actually this I have taken, this slide I have taken from one of the article which came up immediately after the 90 days of lockdown. And this is a wonderful work done by a great team of scientists working in NPL, National Physical Laboratory, led by Dr. R.K. Kutnala, who is a well-known national figure, and he is one of the renowned scientists of our country working in green energy pathways in NPL. As Professor Rai was saying, I would like that if any of you is interested, your faculty or any of student want to know more about it, I will see to it that we interact with their team as well. And there are many more teams who are working in this aspect. We will be happy to create that kind of networking in this topic, which really requires a lot of attention now. So here you see that immediately after the first lockdown, they have found that the air quality analysis, they did air quality in which they took the samples of these trace gases in the environment. And these are particulate matter, 2.5 and 10 nanometers. They have done this study across the Delhi. So they found that air quality suggested that lockdown has helped in circumventing the coronavirus community spread. Besides a boon for air quality improvement in unimaginable limits that compels environmentalists to resolve and redirect the environmental pollution issues in new dimensions. And in fact, all of us have felt also, I used to get messages through WhatsApp, no, video messages, in which people were saying that they could see the peaks of Nepal from the Himalayan region, and even the galaxy of stars were so clear. I mean, all of us really felt it in the initial phase of lockdown. Now, what were the other things which we observed? So again, students, you should also tell based on your experience in your region, in your hometown, whatever, like you found that the environment was more cleaner, there was less pollution, there was less emissions. So you also share with us in this paper, you can also go through this paper, which talked about emergence of blue sky over Delhi due to coronavirus disease lockdown implications. Very interesting paper it is. Now, already you have seen industries, IT companies, all these and many more, even at our household, we require huge amount of energy. But energy generation process, it pollutes our environment and the sources of energy also, air, water, soil. I mean, all the natural resources are also getting utilized when we do this job by using them. So how to mitigate our pollution? Adaptation already I have mentioned you. How to mitigate? Again, this is a question I am posing to you. How will you take up this challenge? All you young minds, you come up with this answer as well. In our Indian condition, how can we mitigate the pollution in a simplest manner? You have to give ideas. You have to give us small solutions. And I would like to see that what kind of answer I get on my this slide as well. I will expect your answer. Then only I'll understand that you have understood the crux of the thing. Now, this is my last slide, almost last, second last. So here, the COVID vis-a-vis climate change. Sorry. There are short as well as long-term impact of climate change. Both are caused by rich. Rich means not rich people. I will say the developed countries, the more advanced communities, they are using all kind of technological tools. Technologies are good. They make our lives easier. But at the same time, there is a cost which all of us have to pay for it. And everyone gets impacted, whether they are using it or not, but they are impacted by the ill effect of these things. COVID helped reduce air pollution, as I mentioned through this article, and there are many more articles. I was going through some of the articles today. Those are very interesting. And I will request the students from who will be having environment in their syllabus. They should initially, now your Delhi University session is going to start from 10th of August. So you should start picking up these aspects first and give your ideas, maybe in the form of some tutorial or maybe in the form of small articles. You come up. And in DST, we have started a very, very famous, very popular program, which is Avsar. Avsar is one program which we have started, in which every year we identify popular writing, popular article writing. If you can write an article in the popular form, in a language which is understandable by everyone, by the society, and just submit to us online in DST's website, and we identify 100 such articles and give them 10,000 rupees. That is a prize or award. One award also we give to them. And this is for graduate and postgraduate. I think all of you should see this particular program and write your article on this. COVID likely to have long-term positive impact on environment as the world adopts work from home culture with reduced travel. So work from home, this itself, all of us had faced, and students, all of you are really working online, sitting from your home, even faculty members as well. So there is a positivity or positive thing that, okay, it is minimizing the emissions and, you know, environment friendly things are coming up. But at the time, the travel time has reduced. But in one go, it is positive. It is helpful for the environment. In other go, there are negative impact also. Reverse impact is also there. So all of you have to explore that what are the positive and negative impact of climate change, of COVID on climate change. These are some of the things which at the central level we face, that fund availability. The country's economy, the global economy is also getting affected because of COVID. So the availability of funds, resources have minimized. And there is a mandatory clause of social distancing. So sharing and pooling, as I was mentioning, of the transportation, that is again can be done up to certain limit. So these are certain things, and the list is quite big. You can also add on to. These are certain things which I thought I just added to it. So this is my last slide. It talks about the World Economic Forum in the COVID action platform. Whole world is thinking we are together. All nations are together in this time, in this challenging time. And here there are certain inter-cross-sectoral issues at the global scale. These are not only limited to national boundaries now. All countries are joining hands. They are discussing in their own way. And there are many levels of discussion points in which there are common platforms. There, everybody is endorsing or advocating that the climate environmental degradation is there, inequalities are there, climate destabilization is happening in their own way. The degrees may be different, but it is happening all across the world. And up to a certain level, the parallels need to be drawn between the current COVID pandemic and some of the contemporary crises which world is facing. We should discuss and try to bring out certain solutions together, because as I said, they are, all of us are facing the same problems. The degrees may be different, but solutions may be more or less same kind of. So there is a need to go for a global to local response, which our Prime Minister sir also mentioned through his new programs, that global to local response is required. Atmanirbhar Bharat, that also he is promoting, and all of us should join hands in our own level to that mission. And we should have long-term thinking. All need to be guided by science. Science is again the main force behind all this, and need to protect the most vulnerable among us. In overall, we can say that the coronavirus pandemic may lead to a deeper understanding of the ties that bind us on a global scale, and could help us to get various information or the information systems which can combat, which can help us in coming out from the climate crisis. The well-resourced healthcare systems are essential to protect us from health security threats, including climate change. The support to reinstigate the economy after the pandemic should promote. Now, these are the buzzwords which are coming up all across the globe. We should look towards programs which promote health, equity, and environmental protection. So I leave the session open to all of you to think, to visualize, to imagine that how, as a young researcher, as a young scientist, or a child scientist, you are no more a child scientist, but I will call all of you young scientists, can, with your wise, with your wisdom, with the guidance of your teachers, your faculty, you can give us the ideas, and then further can lead to